Hi, I'm Yonatan Naamad. I'm going to be discussing multi-commodity flow within network processing. This is based on joint work with Moses Charikar, Jennifer Rexford, and Kelvin Zhou. So this is really going to be a two-part talk. In the first part, I'll introduce the routing and steering problem, which is entirely continuous. After that, we'll segue into the second section, network design, which relies on our results from this first section, but it's more of a discrete type of problem. So I don't need to tell you all that computer networks these days are really dual purpose. In addition to actually routing the flow, they also oftentimes have some additional services, or the middle boxes in the network also have these services that they sometimes perform. There are lots of different services that that are currently implemented. And these new uses of computer networks require new algorithms. This has been mentioned a lot of times earlier today, but historically, middle boxes were kind of single purpose. So if something was a firewall, it remained a firewall. But these days, something that's currently a firewall, something that's today a firewall might tomorrow end up having to do video transcoding or something along those lines. And this is possible because of NFV. And so the question that we try to study is, how do we best utilize this newfound flexibility in these middle boxes? Okay, now I'm going to formally state our model. So in our model, we're given a graph G that represents our network. There are, as usual, there are going to be edge capacities. And we're going to have these flow demand pairs, SITI. But the new twist that we're going to be studying is what happens when we also have vertex capacities. These correspond to the amount of processing power that each middle box in the network may or may not have. And finally, our goal is to find a way to simultaneously route and process as much of the flow as possible, meaning that for each between each SI and TI, we want to send a flow that satisfies all of the edge capacities, but at the same time, this flow can allocate one unit of processing to one of the vertices that it goes through, and we don't want to exceed any of these vertex processing constraints either. And we're going to assume that each unit of flow really corresponds to one unit of processing. So this is really a two-part problem. There's both the routing part and the steering part. So in the routing part, we're going to try getting flow from the sources to the sinks. Steering is about getting the unprocessed flow over to the processing vertices in the graph. Each of these problems individually is really easy based on previous work. So the first part is multi-commodity flow, and the second part is really just max flow. But what we studied is the joint optimization problem of where we want to maximize both simultaneously. This problem admits a pretty natural walk-based linear program, just like multi-commodity flow. So if you temporarily pretend that this constraint is not there, this is more or less just the multi-commodity flow linear program. All you need to do to reconstruct this LP is to basically add a constraint that says each flow path assigns it, each flow path picks one vertex as its processing node, and no vertex ever exceeds its processing capacity after we accumulate all of the flows together. So this is very easy to do, but unfortunately, the size of this program is potentially exponential. And again, like multi-commodity flow, one can try to write an edge-based linear program. And that is entirely possible, but it's not possible to fit that on this slide. So instead of actually going through the full linear program, I'm just going to give a brief overview of what that entails. Basically, instead of having one variable for each edge corresponding to how much flow is going through it, we now have two variables. We have one variable corresponding to the total amount of flow, and one corresponding to the yet unprocessed flow. Processed flow can be deduced by subtracting one from the other. Then you add a bunch of constraints that basically ensure that that things work as they should. So you shouldn't have more unprocessed flow than you have total flow, things along those lines. And then you have more or less reasonable other constraints. Most of them are the same ones that you'd see for multi-commodity flow. There's nothing too complicated here. The actual complicated part is the analysis of this LP, that is showing that this linear program is actually equivalent to the walk-based linear program. While for multi-commodity flow, this is more or less straightforward, there is a bit of a snag for our version of the problem, because in some cases, the optimal solution might reuse edges. So here's an example of a graph. If you ignore the colored edges for now, and assume and pretend that each black edge has capacity 10, whereas each node has processing capacity equal to what's written within it, it's easy to verify that the only way to get any processed flow from S to T actually requires using this bottom edge twice. And so even though that bottom edge has capacity 10, we only end up being able to send 5 units of flow across, or 5 units of processed flow across from S to T, because we have to use, we have to split it in half for each of the two uses. Yeah.
So actually, I'm actually surprised because the drop thing is actually easy to model as a linear program, because you've tried to do this at some point. Maybe there's an offline question. You've tried to do it. It seems like there are dependencies. Let's say, for example, there's an IPS that drops 10% of the traffic of malicious traffic, and there's two IPs on the path. Then it seems like there's like at least a quadratic dependency, because it's like 10% of 10% of what variable was used in the previous hops.
Yeah. So.
It doesn't seem like a linear thing if you do the edge-based LP. Maybe if you can.
Yeah. Can we take this offline?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, I should have mentioned that. So we can write this LP, but we do have to take care in the analysis. But actually, you can prove that the two linear programs are actually equivalent. And this is really a three-step process. The proof basically works as follows. First, we take our solution and get rid of any kind of weird cycles that don't actually do anything that might show up in the optimal solution for whatever reason. Next, we argue that we give some structure, we prove some structural theorem that says after you've gotten rid of all of these extra loops, any cycle that repeats an edge must contain at least some edge for which the amount of unprocessed flow going through it the first time as opposed to the second time in the walk-based LP. Must actually have a significant drop in the amount of unprocessed flow, and this edge we actually show how we can peel that out of the linear programming solution, and then we continue with the rest of the graph, and eventually we're going to get to the solution where we don't have any of these strange cycles, at which point the multi-commodity flow analysis works directly. So in conclusion, there's an algorithm to convert between these two linear programs, so they're equivalent, which is awesome. This gives us a polynomial time algorithm for solving this problem. But it's a very big polynomial, and so we looked into also trying. We also wanted to find a faster algorithm that might solve this problem in a more reasonable amount of time. And we didn't quite manage to do that, but we did find one minus epsilon approximation that works in roughly quadratic time. This is based on the Garg-Koneman construction for this multiplicative weights algorithm. I'm not going to be able to get into detail, so if you want to see more about that, feel free to talk to me afterwards or check out the paper. Now, to test how useful our results are, we also ran some simulations on traces from the Abilene network. Now, these traces, they are all about routing packets from one location to another, but they don't talk at all about processing. So we didn't really know how much processing power to simulate with at the various vertices. So we came up with two different distributions that we studied. One in which every middle box gets an equal amount of processing capacity, and the other where a random subset of half of the middle boxes get capacity and half don't. And as a benchmark, we're going to we came up with something that we call the naive algorithm, which is it's a variation on the path selection algorithm, but it's more naive than that. And the idea there is basically we're going to solve the multi-commodity flow problem first, get the various walks out of that. Now, conditioned on using exactly these flow paths, we then compute the optimal way to process these flows. And then we throw out anything that we didn't manage to process. And these are the results of the simulations. So the dashed lines correspond to the two algorithms when half of the vertices have processing capacity and half don't. The two solid lines correspond to the case when all vertices have processing capacity. And as you can see, there's at least when the processing capacity is non-trivial, there becomes a non-trivial gap between the two. And if we look at the ratio, we can see that both cases actually, at least for in some regime, there is a gap of something like 25% between the two algorithms. So having an optimal algorithm might actually be useful in some cases. Okay. Now I'm going to transition into the network design section, which I won't have a lot of. I won't really get into much detail here. The first section was all about utilizing middle boxes optimally. But what happens if the middle boxes are not placed in the network yet? What we wanted to study is how do you optimally purchase middle boxes at various locations in the network so to maximize the amount of processed flow that can be actually routed and steered. So formally, we're given a graph G. We're given the set of flow demands. And now for each vertex, instead of being given its processing capacity, we're instead told how much it costs to buy a certain amount of processing capacity at that vertex. And we're going to have multiple problems, so kind of the objective here is stated a bit vaguely. But what we're looking to do is we're looking to optimize on this instance how much we can actually route through the network. So there are two really natural problems to study here. There's the maximization problem and the minimization problem. In budgeted maximization, we have a fixed budget, and we're told, okay, we are not allowed to exceed this budget at all. How do we maximize the amount of the demand? How do we maximize the amount of the demand that can actually be routed in the network, subject to not exceeding this budget? The minimization problem says we have all of these demands. We want to route all of them. We can't miss anything. How do we use as little budget as possible so to make that happen? And for both of these, you can ask the directed and the undirected problem. Turns out all of these are NP-hard. So in terms of exact algorithms, we're not going to be able to do anything. But from an approximation point of view, you can actually do something for each of these up to some minor caveats. So I'm not going to go into what these caveats are. But the takeaway is that although none of these admit a PTAS or something like that, where you can get arbitrarily good approximations, everything has actually a pretty reasonable approximation to it, either constant or logarithmic or something along those lines. And so, yeah, that's the end. Yeah?
So for the first problem, you know, so the node capacity, I remember there's a standard technique to split the node into like an edge. So is that can reduce your problem to the multi-commodity problem?
So that's a very natural question. It's a bit different because edges, so the way the paths work is they use the capacity of every single edge that they cross. But for nodes, they only need to pick one node that does the processing. So it's not, at least we didn't find any way to implement the fact that you only pick one node at which to do the processing using your type of technique. Does that make sense?
Yeah.